Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, that's nice. Thank you so much. And you are welcome this morning to be in the presence of God. And you know, your response gives me energy for the focus of this service, because we're talking about focusing on your mission. If you are on a mission, you need that energy. So let's say it again. I would say, the Lord is good. And all the time. See, we need all that energy. And I invite you to take the call to worship as you stand, so that we can have the call to worship together. Just center your mind. Focus your mind as we read this. We're not just going through the motions, but just center on this call to worship. There is none like you, O Lord. And all the nations you have made shall come and shall glorify your name. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you because there is none like unto thee. There is no one that can be compared with you. And that is why this morning we are so excited to think and to give our hearts unto you, and to recognize the fact that you and you are the greatest commander of our lives. There is nothing we can do on our own, but with you, who is the God who directs us. You who are the God who draws us closer to you. You that have invited us to come to your presence. I pray, O God, that you help us to bow before your presence as we worship. And Lord, as you have given us a mission to be your people wherever we find ourselves, I pray that in the name of Jesus, O God, whatever will stand between us and accomplishing your mission in our lives and in the lives of those we love that are around us and even beyond, Father, I pray that you remove such obstacles and help us, O Lord, to move in victory, because we know that we have a Father who is there to take care of us. As we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Now it's time to have the opening hymn.
Into new days bright,
Be seated.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunday worship service. There are attendance pads on the hooks in your pew. Please sign it and pass it down. The flowers on the altar are given by Gordon and Rosalie Hoff for September birthdays. The United Methodist Church is taking applications for the staff position of administrative assistant. If you are friendly, with an upbeat attitude, a team player, organized, skilled in computer experience and all forms of communication, have a genuine desire to be helpful and positive in the workplace and seek a God-oriented atmosphere, then please apply to join our positive, helpful team. Applications may be obtained at the church office or call 308-762-3434 if you have any questions. The prayer walk is every Thursday at 7 p.m. at Lang Lake and Mondays at 7 a.m. at the track. Please come and join us as we walk and pray. We are scheduled to do Meals on Wheels for the month of September. We are in desperate need of someone to fill in for September 22nd through the 26th. We have been informed that there are only 6 meals to deliver on the weekend, and it only takes about an hour or so. There is a sign-up sheet in the narthex, or contact Renita during the week if you wish to volunteer. The Alliance Methodist Church is planning a winter giveaway ministry on October 1st and October 2nd. These items could be clothing, outerwear, headgear, footwear, bedding, or any item that a family might need for cold weather. Items that are clean, new, or gently used for child or adults would be greatly appreciated. Thank you. If you have any prayer requests or concerns, call the church office or message us on our Facebook page. If you wish to give online, please see our Facebook page and click the Shop Now button. If you have any questions, feel free to call Renita at the church. If you would be interested in mowing the lawn, the sign-up sheet is in the narthex. Thank you for your help. And also, a clipboard is being passed around if you want to help with the coat giveaway on the 1st and 2nd of October. Please sign up. Thank you very much.
I want us to thank God for the successful surgery of Janine Bulad, and she's back home. Thank God for the healing she's experiencing. I also want to thank God for Theresa Hoff. She had back surgery, and there was a little bit of some complications. They had to end up going to Lincoln to try to get things fixed. But we praise God. They got back home yesterday, and I was able to pray together with them. She's doing very much better. So it's a praise. Just keep praying for her for a speedy recovery. Let us pray for Carl Shaw Sr., who has COVID and is in the hospital in Lincoln on a ventilator. And I want us to also continue to keep Darlene, Daughtry, who was diagnosed with cancer. Let's pray for God's guidance for the doctors as they take care of her. I also want us to keep praying for Ethan, that is Becky Mitchell's nephew, who has COVID. It's a long journey, but we are trusting God for his recovery. So keep him in prayer, please, and just pray for many others that we do not even know, or some that don't feel comfortable sharing what is happening, but God knows. So pray for God's healing in their lives. And I want to thank all of you. Last Sunday, I announced about the tragic incidents that happened in my home church in Nigeria, where the pastor was killed. I didn't want to post this again, but that same Sunday in the evening, these people that hate the gospel went and killed 11 people in the same church and wounded one lady who was taken to the hospital. But on Tuesday, she couldn't make it, so she died. On Monday, they buried 11. On Tuesday, they buried one. And on Wednesday, they buried Reverend Silas. So I want you to continue to pray for our church. I spoke to the wife. Well, the whole thing is another pastor would need to be sent, and they are staying in the parsonage. They were able to start a little house somewhere, but are unable to finish it. The children are in school. The wife doesn't work. So our hearts have been heavy with Esther, and we are trying to see if we can send some help. And if you want to be a part of that, please, you can send a check to the church here, and the donation will be coming directly from the church and sent there. But the most important thing we really want is your prayers, and you pray for these people. They're paying for the price of being God's children in a way that it's not even understandable. I mean, it doesn't make sense. So just be in prayer, please. Not only them, there are other people in other places around the world that are passing through severe persecution. So just ask God for his intervention. I have good news for us. Forget about that one for now. If you can turn around and see Lee and Janice are here, it so delights my heart. You know, Lee had told me how they would love to be in church when we get back to 10:30, because sometime early in the morning is not very easy. So you are warmly welcome to church this morning. It gladdens our hearts. And if it does gladden your heart, please clap your hands again. This is what our prayers can do. Let's just keep praying for each other and encourage one another. So, Janice, how are you? Not too bad. Well, we thank God. Yeah, I know. We thank God for your life. All right, let's pray. Father, even when our hearts are heavy sometime, you find a way to give us what to praise and thank you for. And you keep us going, no matter how difficult it is. And this is one of the things that, Lord, we can say thank you for Janine Bullard, for Teresa, and thank you for Janice and Lee. Thank you because of the so many good works that you are doing. I just pray that you take the glory for even the things that sometimes we don't recognize that you are doing. I pray that you take all the glory and honor because you are faithful. I want to pray at this time, O Lord, for those that are not doing well. Thank you for Carl, and thank you, O God, for everything that he is passing through. Thank you for Darlene, and thank you for Ethan. Thank you, Father, for many others that are going through situations. As a family of families, your church, we're lifting these people unto you. We are asking that, Lord, you speak, you reach out to them, you touch them, because we know that it is you that heals. Lord, be with us and guide us, even as we continue with this worship service, that you will accept every part of it to the glory of your name. Because we pray, knowing fully that you answer us in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Now I'll invite the ushers to come forward for the offering so that we can pray together. Lord, it's a thing of joy to come before your presence and bring a token out of the so much you have blessed us with. And we're praying, oh God, for all the offerings that will be put in this plate today, the ones that are given online, the ones that are sent by mail. Father, I pray that, oh God, you bless them and sanctify them to the use of your kingdom. I pray thee, oh God, that those, oh God, that are given, teach us daily, oh God, to give ourselves first unto you. Even those that do not have, Lord, teach us, oh God, to offer ourselves as an offering unto you, that you will use us to be a blessing, to be the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ wherever we find ourselves. Because we pray everything in Jesus' name. Amen. May be seated, please.
Good morning again. Today's scripture reading comes from Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Thank you. And now it's time for children's time.
Good morning, everybody. How are you today?
Good.
So I'm going to tell you a quick story. This is actually a vase because I didn't have a bottle, but This is a little message that I tied up, and I want every one of you to take it home with you. Listen very closely, and I'll tell you what to do with it. So have you ever read a story or seen a movie about someone putting a message in a bottle and throwing it in the water, and maybe somebody finds it, and maybe they don't? Perhaps it was someone who was stranded on an island in the middle of the ocean, or maybe it was someone who just wanted to see where the wind and waves might take the message. I read a true story about a man named Harold Myers. He went on a cruise on a Caribbean ship. Do you know what that is? Big, giant ship, fantastic trip. Well, he had an idea while he was on that ship. He took three bottles, he placed a message with his name and address and a dollar in each side of the bottle. The dollar was to pay for the stamp so that the person who found it next would then write to him and tell him where they found it. Next, he put a cork in the bottle and he sealed them with wax. So I don't have a cork and I don't have wax, but he dropped a message in a bottle just like this and sealed it up. And then he tossed them all three into the ocean. All of his friends laughed at him and said that he was just throwing good money into the water. But what happened next to those bottles was quite amazing. One of those three bottles that he threw into the ocean didn't make it back to him, but two of them were found, and he received a reply from the person who found it. Two out of three. That's pretty cool, huh? To tell you the truth, Mr. Myers said he was shocked. He never expected to hear from anybody at all. So I was thinking perhaps it might be a good way to spread the message of Jesus all around the world. We could write John 3:16 on pieces of paper. You guys know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, so that whoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We could write that on a piece of paper and put it in the bottle and drop it in the ocean. The good news of Jesus would float all around the world. Does that sound like a good plan to you? It does sound like a good plan. But to tell you the truth, it's not going to work that way. I don't think that they would get the message of God's love to very many people. What would be a good way to get the good news of God's love to people all around the world? Jesus told his disciples how he wanted it done, and the plan is still just as good today as it was then. Jesus said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded to you." Jesus wants us to tell everyone we meet about his love for them and share with them what he has taught us in the Bible. He didn't say send a message in a bottle. He said go and make disciples. So my challenge is to you is to share that little piece of paper that I wrapped up and gave to you with somebody that you meet today, whether it's your grandma or your grandpa, a stranger on the street, somebody you meet in the grocery store. I want you to share the word of God with somebody that you meet, because that is how Jesus wants us to do it. And pray with me. Dear Father, help us to obey the command that you gave us to go and make disciples. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and join with me as we sing our next hymn, "Here I Am, Lord." My hand.
snow and rain. I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you
be seated.
Well, I want to bring us an illustration so that we just think of it. And some may understand this illustration. Can you reduce me a little bit? The volume is too loud. Some may understand this illustration better than others. I've never been in the army or in any of the armed forces, but I guess that the people that use the word so much and so much and so much, the word I'm going to talk about today is in the army or in the armed forces, and that is mission. The military have what they call a mission. So they're given an assignment, they have something to do, and they go and do it. And those of us that have maybe been close to those in the army or those that have been in the army would tell this. I think if I thought well, probably I would have interviewed one of them as part of this message so that you understand what I'm talking about. The military exists to carry out the mission of who is their superior, their commanding officer. He gives the command, and the troops go on to fulfill that command. They sit down and strategize, spend days and sometimes months, depending on the complexity of the mission. And they go and execute it. And when they are executing that mission, they execute it with precision. There is none among the troops that will come out and say, well, no, I don't want to be a part of the mission. Oh, I don't want to do it how we planned it. I will just do it my way. Those of you that have been in the army, if you have people people in your troop that decide not to follow on with the mission, let's just say something out of your head. What do you think will happen? There will be chaos. What? A reprimand. Court martial. Yeah. You know, that is what happens. They will bring failure to that battalion or whoever has that mission to carry out. And I want you to understand that there are different kinds of missions. Some of them are covert missions. People cannot talk about it. Some of them are missions that they just carry out. Now, come to think of it, if a mission is given to go and rescue a hostage or someone somewhere, you know how serious that is. Somebody is held captive. And the commanding officer has been given instruction to take his or her troops to go and rescue that person or those people. There'll be a lot of planning. There'll be a lot of sleepless nights, wondering all kinds of scenarios that will come. They will play it out and rehearse it so that they can rescue the hostages alive and bring them back to where they're supposed to be. You know, I've never seen Matthew chapter 28 from verse 19 in terms of God's mission to his church as compared to the mission of the military. But when I began to think of it that way, it gave me a new light. Okay, so when you think about God's mission, you may be asking, what is that mission? But you know, God's mission is not just actually in Matthew 28. God's mission is in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14. And this is the thing. This is what God wants to happen. It says, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the water covers the sea. That is what God wants. He wants the whole earth to be covered with the knowledge of the glory of God as the waters cover the sea. Now, if you think about that, he sent Jesus Christ to come, and Jesus did everything to see that he carried out that mission, bringing the glory of God through miracles, through teachings, through preaching, and everything he did. And when he was about to leave, he gave his disciples instructions on how they can key into that mission. So God's mission is that the glory of the Lord, the knowledge of the glory of God, will fill the entire earth as the water covers the sea. And how he wants to accomplish that is what we have in Matthew 28, the final chapter of Matthew. You know, starting from verse 19, this is what Jesus said. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands that I have given you. And be well assured that I am with you to the end of the age. You know, I would really want us to understand that God's overall mission is that the knowledge of the glory of God will fill the earth. And he seeks to accomplish that through you and I actually going out, just like he told his disciples, to make disciples of all nations. Now, in this verse, there are three things that I want us to pay attention to, because if we are to do that, we need to pay attention to that. First of all is where to go. You know, there has been a misconception about this mission of God. For a very long time, people thought that the mission was to go to places where Jesus has not been known. Now we make him known. We go there to preach. Or we send our mission support there. Now, this is the point, that everybody that becomes a Christian keys into God's mission. You become a part of the troops that are to carry out that mission. And not all of us will leave Alliance, Nebraska and go elsewhere and go far away in other countries to be missionaries. That is why the supplemental verse for this is Acts chapter 1 verse 8, where Jesus made it clear, even though he had given them in the last chapter of Matthew, how they are to carry out this mission. But to avoid the misconception that mission is taking place there, he said to them, clearly, you will be my... Let me just read it. He said, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. Telling people about me everywhere. And he gave them the map from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You see, in this verse, Jesus shows the important principle of starting God's mission from right where you are. Because the disciples were in Jerusalem, and he said, you will be my witnesses, telling people about the knowledge of the glory of God, the message of salvation, beginning from where you are. Not from there, but from here. And I want you to understand this, that he was not saying you start from the church. Actually, you are to start from your sphere of influence. You are to start even from your home or from your office, from among your friends. In essence, we have to be people who understand the importance of God's mission right here in our community, right here in our families. We have people that, even though they say they know God, but truly they don't understand. We have people who think that they are Christians, but they don't really understand what it means to be a Christian. I mean, if you think I'm kidding, just go out and just say, hey, I'm doing a survey. My pastor actually asked me to just ask a question. What does it mean to be a Christian? So that you are not putting it on their face. Just blame it on your pastor, right? Just say, he asked me to ask. Some people may say, who is this, your pastor? Tell me, I'm going to punch him. Tell them where I live. But you have to also send the police to come and defend me anyway. So, well, this is the point. The truth of the matter is many people do not really understand what it means. And Jesus was saying, start from where you are. You don't have to go to Afghanistan. to carry out God's mission. You don't have to go to Kuwait. You don't have to go to China. You don't have to go to Nigeria. You can start from your circle of influence. Just talking to people and just know if they really know what this is all about. And you know what? If we are not carrying out God's mission, beginning from where we are, then we are being like that member of the troop that said, I don't want to do it. It's not by choice. It may be by your life. It may be by your speech as you talk to them. But we are to carry out God's mission. And God's mission may involve talking to people or just doing something for somebody. And it makes a difference. Because you can be the hands and the feet of Jesus to someone that is right around you. And that's how they know that Jesus is alive and he speaks. So where to go? It starts from here. And then it goes there. You cannot say, I am doing mission over there. And you are destroying mission right here. So we need to start from here and then we go there. That's what Jesus wants. That is how he will bless our efforts. That's how he will change our lives and he will use us. For some of us, the main thing is the way that things are happening in our lives. We feel like we cannot obey this command. Oh, I am too shy. But I think even if you are too shy, you can take a step and Jesus will definitely use you. The second thing. Now, what to say in this God's mission? Or what to teach? You know, the call to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think I need some water here. Sorry. The call to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not like it is something that you have to create what to say. But Jesus said to them, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. You know, I have not thought of baptism as part of this mission on how to carry out this mission. Until recently, when I was thinking about this verse, I said, oh, Lord, this is important. Jesus wants us to bring people to his kingdom and baptize them. Then you may say, oh, okay, well, but that's not my job description. It's your job description that you're telling me. You're saying that I should go and baptize? No. The point is, your job is to bring the people, then I will baptize them. Do you realize that sometime, even in the families of those of us that call ourselves believers, that we still have people that are not baptized? It may surprise you that in a church like this one, you may even find adults that are not baptized, but this is the mission. The mission is very clear. Make disciples, baptize them. So it's an invitation to you, all of us here. I don't want to be specific to anybody, but you know, if there be anybody within your circle of influence, be it a child or be it an adult that has not been baptized, part of you obeying and carrying out this mission is you lead them and bring them to the path of being baptized. And the baptism is to be done in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. That is the Trinity. And teaching them to obey what I have commanded you. Now, this is the thing, that all that you teach, God help you. I believe all of us here have been in school. How would you feel? You go to class, first day of fourth semester, teacher comes in. It's a chemistry class. The teacher comes and says, well, I just want you to know, I have never studied chemistry. I don't know anything about chemistry, but I'm so glad I'm going to be your teacher. How would you feel? Come on, how would you feel? Let's talk to me. What? I'm not going to learn anything. I just feel like taking my books and just walking away. I want to humbly say that at some point, when we try to make disciples, we have a lot of setback because we have not availed ourselves to know what to teach them, to teach the disciples. You know, the Bible is like an ocean that the greatest philosopher and scientist can get into it and get drowned. Yet, it is so shallow that a baby can come in and swim in it. The Bible has a starting point for you. Please, disciples of Jesus Christ in Alliance UMC, let us avail ourselves and allow the Holy Spirit to teach us so that we can teach others. And that's why Paul in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, he said, the things that I have heard, I pass them on to you. That was Paul talking to Timothy. I have passed them on to you so that you will pass them on to faithful men and women. I beseech you, therefore, brothers and sisters, I plead with you that you have some form of organized, systematic place where God's word is taught and you are part of it. The best thing that happens to me is when I'm part of the men's Bible study on Monday. I love to learn from those men. I love to listen. That we just talk about scriptures. Find somewhere to plug yourself in because it is part of the mission. You have to get instructions about the mission of God. And you have to focus on that so that you can carry out the mission. It's the instruction. It's like the blueprint of the mission. And if you don't have the blueprint of the mission, you will mess up. And that's what God wants us to do. We need to learn God's word so that we can teach it to others. Not only teaching it to others, but we apply it to ourselves. And no one, including me, including my professors, some of them that are as smart as anything you can think of, they cannot say we have known all of God's word. So we need to find a place in this church and key in. We have Sunday school classes. We have small groups that meet. Some of them call themselves like Sunshine Girls or something like that, very beautiful names, you know. Some of them, they very cool names. Plug in. It's a place where you have fun and learn about the mission so that you execute the mission. You want this church to grow. You want this church to be here in the next few years to come. It's when we soak ourselves into God's word, then we will carry out God's mission. All the noise we are making, it doesn't matter. You can have a pastor that either knows something or doesn't know anything. All that counts to make the church grow is that the people sitting on the pews, they know and love God. That they have the knowledge of the glory of God and they can leave it out. Because all that it takes, a pastor is here for a few years, he's gone or she is gone. But Alliance UMC, I will be very glad when I get old and I'm about to retire. I say, I want to go and retire in Alliance. And I come, this church will still be here. I didn't hear an amen. Yeah. But it depends on what you and I do right now. Okay. Now, the last thing is, Jesus made it clear to them that he was going to be with them. He said, and lo, I am with you to the end of the ages. From the very beginning of time, God created man and woman and said he wanted to be with them and have fellowship with them, but sin came over and brought a separation. But Jesus brought back that position where we can be renewed. I want you to know that whatever part of the mission, no matter how complicated it is, he's with you. He is with you, and he is going to lead you through. And God's mission can be as difficult as anything when you think of it that way, but it can be as simple as anything because the presence of the Holy Spirit is with you. That's why how he lightens your burden. That's how you are able to come here and serve. You are able to do things to the glory of God in the church without complaining. But if you find yourself complaining because you love Jesus or because you come to church on Sunday morning, if you find yourself complaining, probably he is not in what you're doing. So I invite us all to say a prayer now that we are in a mission that is so important and none of us can be left out. We're part of that mission. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Heavenly Father, your mission, O God, is our mission. And you want us to carry it out with precision. But most of the times we have failed. Help us from this time as we go forward to focus on our mission that you have given us as a church and as individuals. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand and join with me as we sing our closing hymn, Freely, Freely, on page 389.
Now, dear Lord, as we participate in your mission, which has become our mission, may the presence of your Holy Spirit go before us as you have promised, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.